The ignorance of man, which is the exact reverse of our basic process. Instead of man rising to greatness, he drew greatness down to himself until it became less and less great. And the less great it became, the more willingly he accepted it. But when it reached a certain degree of not being great, it became such a caricature of itself that man began to ridicule the procedure and reject the very things which he had himself had brought about. Thus, out of the gradual degeneration of things also rose skepticism, or a general disillusionment about knowledge or the essence of fact itself. This position causes Pike to look back, and he would like to find, or would like to believe from his researches, that the great structure of this basic doctrine was in a strange pristine purity between 7 and 10,000 years before the beginning of the Christian era, perhaps much longer. But he wants to be as conservative as he can. He believes that this revelation, this basic knowledge, preceded the first of the Zoroasters. He believed that they drank at its fountain as all others did. He believes very definitely that the entire philosophy of the Zoroastrian doctrine is rooted in this thing, which, like the mysterious principle at the root of Zoroastrianism itself, an absolute, an infinite, an ultimate and utter state of existence, that this eternal life itself was man's primordial symbol of eternal wisdom, that this mysterious power at the very source of things, Ahura Mazda, or whatever level he goes beyond and behind that concept also, but that this creating power, the source of all wisdom, the one who communicates to his saints and sages, the mysterious power that is forever the oracle, was not merely the voice of a deity, not merely something that appeared in thunders, but was actually a statement of the existence of a holy order, a sacred body of enlightened beings, human by nature, with a strange but total penetration into reality. And that everything that has since followed has come from that, and has gradually, in the course of time, fallen away from that, until we have relatively forgotten the original teachings of the ancient ones of the earth. Now let us see how Pike would proceed with this, because he realized that he would be open to criticism for such a statement. He would realize that someone would say, but these persons could not have known this. They could not have known that. Certainly we have made some advancements in knowledge. Certainly as we look back, we find indication of man living in a more and more primitive state. Certainly the whole trend of our concept is that man has arisen from darkness into light. Pike, however, doesn't think so. Pike says man has fallen from light into darkness because of a false estimation of what constitutes light, or perhaps a false definition of the meaning of darkness. Whichever term you wish to use, man has come to a false explanation of the meaning of the term, or a false concept of origin based upon it. Now Pike then points out another interesting situation. Namely, that when we would destroy truth, we must complicate it. We must make it difficult. And the more difficult we make it, the more difficult it is for anyone to find out anything. Of course, Pike does not use the story, but I think I have told it, but it is a rather cute one, to the effect that one day two men were walking along side by side, one a human soul and the other the devil. And right in front of them was another man walking by himself. And the man in front leaned over and picked up something, looked at it, and slipped it in his pocket. And the man with the devil said, what did he pick up? And the devil said, oh, this man has just found a small grain of truth. The man with the devil said to him, well, that's going to make it pretty tough for you, isn't it? The devil said, oh, no, I'm going to help him organize it. Now, Pike's thinking on this is exactly this point. He says, we assume that the motion from the primitive to the sophisticated is evolution. And Pike says, I doubt it very, very severely. I think we have longer words to say it with than ever before, but I do not think we know as much about what we're saying. Gradually, by degrees, we have fallen into this opinionism, which, as Heraclitus says, is the falling sickness of the reason. And as a result, we know much about many things and very little of the fact beneath things. So Pike, going back to the beginning, says it wasn't necessary for this ancient body, whatever it may have been, to have been able to square the circle. They didn't need to know trigonometry and calculus. They did not need to write histories. They did not need to compile philosophies. They did not need to develop or originate religions per se, for the simple reason that all of these things belong finally not to the spreading of wisdom, but man's combating of ignorance. Instead of assuming that these are the way man came to know, actually they were the ways in which man began to search for something lost, or something that he believed to be knowable, but which in its substance eluded him. Therefore, direct knowledge, the only knowledge that is true, the knowledge that carries with it the total internal experience of fact, is a kind of knowledge we know nothing about, and we have almost no way of assuming that that essential knowledge is related to the economic, social, or political development of peoples. That this knowledge, like the intuitive power of a child, might be truer and righter than any knowledge that is later conferred upon that child by education and culture. Thus, the ancient ones of the earth were those, in Pike's thinking, who were the natural knowers. Those who had not been led into error, and therefore did not have to be led out of it. He assumes that man naturally was endowed with faculties for the purpose of experiencing truth, and not for the purpose of fighting ignorance. That until man himself created ignorance, it did not exist. For ignorance is an artificial state in nature. Ignorance is not necessary. It originates in false instruction. It originates in systems by means of which man's intuitive and natural faculties are blunted, in which he loses the capacity for the immediate apprehension of fact, and must therefore depend for knowledge upon sharing the opinions of others. Pike therefore refers to these ancient ones of the earth as the lodge of the old teachers, the holy ones of old, those to whom we have constant reference. And he points again to his circumference, and he points out that every religion and philosophy of man traces itself back to a period of legendary and lore when wisdom was universal. In other words, we can think perhaps of the Greek just as a simple example. But in the beginning was the golden age, when there was no poverty, no ignorance, no sickness, no suffering, and no death. This was the divine era. In the ancient childhood of the world, in the oldest Hindu writings, we find originally this world ruled benevolently and eternally by the gods. There was no disobedience, there was no sin. Although the point is rather congested in the opening chapters of Genesis, the point also exists that presumably the original man lived in a paradisical garden, and here the Lord walked with him in the evening, and he was not ashamed, and he was in communication with the creating powers that have fashioned him and brought him into existence. The same is true of the Egyptian religion, for in the dawn of things there was the golden age, the age of peace and joy, the age before the gods retired to their Olympian strongholds, the age in which nothing but life and peace and happiness prevailed. We find it even among savage people. We find it among our American Indian tribes. For in most of their little local legends, although they are feeble in comparison to the great theological systems of the classical nations, they all begin with the idea that man was happy. They none of them begin with the fact that he was miserable. Nearly all of the systems, and Pike enumerates probably 20 or 30 of them, they all declare that man began in peace. That for thousands of years, millions of years, perhaps aeons of time, there were no wars. Then in one way or another, rebellion set in. There was war in heaven. Some of the angels resisted their Lord. And there was the battle between Michael and Lucifer in the old Jewish legendary. Someone became selfish. Someone became corrupt, and the great and splendid pageantry of the divine will was mutilated and deformed and in measure destroyed by the rise of human will. And man's own egoism, his own selfishness, his own determination to live his own way gradually caused the golden age to die. Pike's one point, however, is well taken, that if we accept that legendary and mythology and lore belongs to a kind of subconscious memory of man, a memory which psychology perhaps says goes back to human infancy with its irresponsibility. But this again, only symbolic of collective infancy, the rise and dawn of peoples. He is correct in assuming, at least, that all of the great systems of the world agree on this point. They agree that there was a time when man knew, that Adam could name all creatures according to their natures and their attributes, that the ancient ones communicated with mankind, and in practically every great system of legendary, in the dawn of things, gods walked the earth with men. We do not know just exactly how this is explained in things like the Eldorado, or the Sigurd Saga, or the Fridolf Saga, or the Kalevala, or any of these great epical works based upon the ancient legendary and lore of peoples. We have it in Japan, and in the Nohinji and the Kojiki. We have the great sacred writings of the days when the gods ruled the world and men lived in peace. Thus, in the root of things, Pike seemingly took the attitude that all this legendary and lore did not relate merely to a theological abstraction or to some mythological hope or some escape mechanism in man, but that it related distinctly and definitely to a period in which the ancient doctrines, the great wisdom, was directly available to the human being. Directly available to him because he then possessed, by the nature of infancy, the total kind of purity, the total kind of innocence, by means of which he was without sin. Meaning, of course, if we want to go back to the Chaldean and follow Pike's thinking, without sin means not moonstruck. Because Sin was the ancient goddess of the moon. Therefore, without lunacy, without the moon madness, without this strange thing that led man into illusion, for which the moon was an ancient symbol. Regardless of how we want to think of it, let's see how Pike now begins to defend his position. He defends his position by pointing out that as each of the streams left this central core land and began to establish themselves as separate nations and peoples, began to cause the rise of what we might term existence on an individualized basis, that the first thing that each of these groups did was to restore or recreate or perpetuate what he is referred to by Socrates in this quotation which I read, the state mysteries. Now, the state mysteries lie not at the decadence of people, but at their roots. For by the time of the Orphics, 1400 years B.C., the great mysteries of the Greeks were already in decline. By the rise of the Osirian cycle in Egypt, the great mysteries of the Egyptians had fallen, been revised, reformed, regenerated, and fallen again a dozen times. Groups leaving an area all perform the same action, may we safely assume that the area from which they came was unaware of that action, in the sense of never having performed a similar action. May we assume that a certain pattern would proceed out of a center, but the center itself would be unaware of the pattern. Would it be possible that these migrants would have carried something with them that did not exist in the place they came from? And as all of these peoples did bring this, Planck is of the assumption that somewhere in the background of this great Indo-Aryan or Iranian-Aryan culture was the archetype of the great house of the mysteries. That this great house of the mysteries was not necessarily a temple, was not necessarily a great building. Perhaps it was the mysterious grotto, ornamented with stars, into which it is said the Zoroasters disappeared and remained in a kind of waitingness to return. Perhaps it was almost anything. Perhaps it was later symbolized by the great Institute of Meru in India. But whatever it was, Planck was convinced that it represented an assembly or an aggregate of enlightened and informed persons who at that time were responsible for the great pattern which was to arise in the religious and philosophic and even scientific worlds. Inasmuch as the roots of all knowledge were in this core, even though the knowledge itself was as yet undeveloped by man. If Planck is correct, and he gives a great deal of supporting evidence that is rather difficult to refute, to say the least, then he takes the position that the great sages, the great scholars, and he wisely points out that these words that we use now have no real meaning in this pattern, that it represents a quality or a condition of enlightened beings totally different from our concept of the term enlightened beings, because we're using our own words for something else. But the best we can say is that there existed a core of knowers whose knowledge was real, whose knowledge was relatively, at least, absolute, whose knowledge exceeded that of any age that has followed them, and that the whole great search is the effort to recover it. Now, we might say that this is a very retrogressive look, that what we are actually looking for is a great and brilliant future and not an illustrious past. But Planck would cut through that entire point, and in his discussion of the matter of time, he brings out this very simple situation, that the individual who falls under the illusion of past, present, and future is defeated already. He will never find, because he is now applying time to a situation that is timeless, and that therefore nothing that is real is old or new.
The fact that it existed 50,000 years ago does not make it old. The fact that it may be more completely realized 50,000 years from now does not mean that we will discover anything new. For that which is, like the eternal nature of being itself, is eternal. Therefore, we are quibbling when we talk about truth going out of fashion, or old-fashioned or new-fashioned truth. The only thing that can ever go out of fashion is untruth, and we're in trouble until it does. Consequently, what we are not searching for is a dead past. We're not searching for that at all, nor are we striving to bring a dead past to life. What we are searching for is that eternal truth that to our perceptive powers has been locked in a past, locked there as in a sarcophagus, buried there not by the gods but by man, and that it is the rolling away of the stone that lets out not an ancient truth or a new truth, but the truth, which is as new as now and as old as eternity. Consequently,